We're beginning worship a little bit different today. You know, today is a beautiful Sunday for us to gather as we remember those that have served us in our armed forces, and we remember those that have given their lives. But also today is a day in which we celebrate Pentecost, and we have the unique opportunity also to remember the 277th anniversary of John Wesley's altar skate experience on this very day. So we have three things we're thinking about today. And so we invite you to come into this time of worship with your hearts open and your minds prepared, inviting the Holy Spirit. And you have to do this each individually and personally, but we'll do it corporately, inviting the Holy Spirit to take control. Rejoin with me as we pray. Father, we thank you for this day, for this is a day that you've made. And it's a day that's unique. And it's a day in which we come together in reverence and in remembrance of lives that have been sacrificed for us as a nation and for the freedoms that we cherish. And today is a day in which we come together in celebration that you love us so much that you were willing to invest yourself in our lives through the gift of your Holy Spirit. And so once again, today is a day in which we say, Lord, send your Holy Spirit upon us as you did on the day of Pentecost, when the believers were all together. And Father, today is a day in which we celebrate the transformation of the heart and of the life and of the faith of John Wesley 277 years ago on this very day. So, Father, as you have transformed lives through each of those areas that we remember and celebrate, send your Holy Spirit upon us today. Revive and refresh and renew and change our hearts and change our minds. And may we be receptive of you today. For this is the prayer that we offer. And we do so in the wonderful name of your Son, our Lord and our Savior, Holy Spirit, our Jesus Christ. And together we say, amen.
I'm Jan Lowe, Minister of Congregational Care, and I'd like to welcome everyone this morning, especially anyone that might be visiting here for the first time. We want to make sure that you get to know this church and you get to be comfortable with it. And one of the ways that we can help make that happen for you is before you leave today, if you will give us your name and address. You can do that on the attendance pad, or you can do that at the desk out in the narthex. So once we have your name and address, later this week, someone will stop by your home to drop off a mug and say thank you for worshiping with us. That mug is going to have information in it that tells about the many ministries and the many ways that we have in our church to serve our Lord, to serve people in this community and beyond, and to serve one another. I hope that sounds good to you. In the meantime, we ask that everyone enjoy the fellowship that is here this morning. We do have attendance pads. I'm sure they've been passed. If someone new has come into the row that you're in, pass them one more time. When we see your name on there, we know that you were here, but it also helps us to figure out who might not have been able to be here this morning. And when we can see that, it helps us to do a better job of staying in touch with our church family. So thank you for helping us with that. If you will open your bulletins to ministry opportunities and events, I've got just a couple that I would like to point out. Helping Hands Workday is Saturday, June 6th. We have two of these official work days for the people of our church a year, and this is one of them. So mm-hmm. if you or you and mm-hmm. your family would like to volunteer to help at Helping Hands on June 6th, please come to the office and sign up, or call the office and sign up so that we can know how many of our folks will be there to help on that day. We also have two opportunities for those people who are caregivers or who are kind of thinking that they may become caregivers before too long. We have someone who is from we have the The daughter and the granddaughter of Barbara Broyles are going to be here on June 8th, which is a Monday morning. They will be here to talk about Alzheimer's and give some tips on the best ways that you can live with someone with Alzheimer's and that you can be the best caregiver possible. Unfortunately, 2 days later, we got very good speakers, but they both had to come so close together. But on June 10th, we're going to have a free lunch and learn that is going to be hosted by the Alzheimer's Association. And they will bring a representative here to talk about the ways to interact with Alzheimer's folks or people that are getting to that point of looking like Alzheimer's or other dementia. So we hope that if that sounds good to you, read the rest of the information in the bulletin, and then we only need you to sign up for the lunch and learn so we can have enough food for everyone. Last but certainly not least is the reception and card shower that we are planning for June 7th for Zach Underwood and his family. We've been talking about this, we're dreading it, but we're gonna make it a happy time. So when you come to church on Sunday morning, the 7th of June, help us celebrate Zach and his family. And we'll make this a special way for him to leave the church and to start a whole new chapter in their lives. Thank you and God bless.
Thank you. Jichan, I am Kuo Kan.
Who is it, Ba?
Pomok noi Lin Mai. Ndakova.
Barbara Riley?
Yes?
Ma'am, it's about your husband. Something's been recovered.
We verified the identification tags for authenticity, and I assume you can speak to the validity of the ring.
I knew the moment I saw it. We had it engraved on our first anniversary. With you forever. Was there anything else?
Ma'am, that's all the fisherman and his son found. But they did give us a location, which means the excavation team knows where to begin the search.
Bless their hearts.
Barbara, this is just a first step, but we're going to do everything we can to find him.
Bring him home.
This morning, as we honor all those who have given the ultimate sacrifice for serving their country, I ask that you would pray with us now as we join together in our congregational prayer. Heavenly Father, on this Sunday before Memorial Day, we remember those who courageously laid down their lives for the cause of freedom. May the examples of their sacrifice inspire in us the selfless love of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Bless the families of our fallen troops and fill their homes and their lives with your strength and peace. In union with people of goodwill of every nation, embolden us to answer the call to work for peace and justice, and thus seek an end to violence and conflict around the globe. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And if you would, will you please stand now for the posting of the colors?
So, Father, today we remember and we give thanks and praise, and we ask you once again to mend our every flaw so that we can be all that we can be for you. For we ask this in the wonderful name of your Son, our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. And together we pray, say, amen. God is good. And all the time. You look so good in your red. Thank you so much for remembering to wear red today. For some of us, that's a struggle. And so I'm glad that you were able to accomplish that. Will you greet those around you and help us to make sure that everyone is made to feel welcome in God's house today.
Ha ha ha. Scripture reading this morning is from Joel 2, verses 28 and 29 from the New International Version. Listen to the word of God. And afterward, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
At this time, if the ushers would come forward, we will continue in worship by presenting our tithes and offerings. It is truly a blessing to come to this time to give back to God in thankfulness for all of the blessings that He has poured out upon each of us. thanksgiving. As we give thanks and give back to you from the blessings that you have poured out upon us, we do so with joyful hearts that we might be a part of your ministry, that we might make a difference, that we might take a stand for you. And we are so thankful that we are able to join in your ministry, to bring your kingdom here upon this earth. And gracious God, we just pray that you would send your Spirit upon us this morning. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Seated. As we enter into this time of prayer, we have some joys and concerns to be lifted up this morning. A joy, Ralph and Mona have made a donation to the church in celebration of their 59th wedding anniversary, so which will be May 26th, so we celebrate with them. Some concerns to be lifted up this morning. We have heard that Terry Crandall is in the hospital, Mercy Hospital, so please be in prayer for Terry. Highland Healthcare, Dale Veach and Lynn Muirhead. Northwest Bentonville, Nita May, who is still struggling with pneumonia, so please continue to be in prayer for Nita. Pat Pershing has actually gone home, so she is no longer in Northwest, but please be continue to be in prayer for Pat as she continues to recover. You'll notice several other names there in need of healing touch: Kim McGee, Linda Ivy, Charlie Corns, several others, and we ask that you would take this handout home with you and be in prayer for these people throughout this next week as we lift them up as a body of believers before God, as we praise Him and as we pray for one another as we go through difficult times, times of struggle, times of pain and heartache. The church that we will be praying for this week, as we continue to pray for churches within the Bella Vista community, is Presbyterian Church of Bella Vista. So please be in prayer for the Presbyterian Church, their pastors, their leaders, their congregations, their congregation, all those whom they find themselves ministering to. At the end of the service, you will be invited to take a more exhaustive prayer sheet home with you of all of the concerns that we are aware of that are taking place within our church family, and you're invited to take that home and be in prayer for everyone this coming week. As we prepare our hearts and our minds for this time of prayer, will you join with me in our prayer song? Come, Holy Spirit, come. Fall afresh on us this morning. As we celebrate Pentecost, as we celebrate the coming of your Spirit upon the disciples and those believers so long ago, we pray this morning for revival. We pray this morning for renewal as your Spirit washes over us anew this morning. Mold us and melt us and form us into your image, that we might portray you to those whom we face this week, that we might share your love, that we might share the fact that you are living in us and among us and around us. You are everywhere, Holy God. You are with us in all things, and we give you the thanks and the praise this morning as we lift those concerns up to you that have been mentioned this morning. As we lift up those who are going through difficult times, times of illness, pain and struggle, heartache, loss of loved ones. And those that we haven't mentioned this morning but are on our hearts, we lift them up and we lay them at your glorious throne this morning. In all of these things, we pray that your will would be done. This morning, we also remember and pray for all those who have paid the ultimate sacrifice in serving their country. Those who have died protecting our freedom. We pray for them and we pray for their families, those whom they have left behind. Those who struggle to continue on, those who face each new day missing their loved one. We pray that your Spirit would rest upon them, that it would comfort them. We pray that you would be with Brother Jaimie this morning as he brings us the message, a message of Pentecost. That your Spirit would fall upon him and that we would have the ears to hear this morning. That we might allow your Spirit to change us. That we wouldn't stay where we are at. That we wouldn't continue to be the people that we are, but that we would allow your love to infiltrate everything that we are and completely change us and make us new this morning. Be with us now as we join together in praying the prayer Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Well, I want to invite you to join with me in the reading of God's Word in Acts, the second chapter. We'll read verses 1 through 4, which is only just a piece of the marvelous expression of God that is being poured out in the hearts and the lives of people in the infant church. So I encourage you to read chapter 1, read chapter 2, read the book of Acts. Go back into the middle of the Gospel of John, where Jesus promised that he would send the Holy Spirit to infuse and enable the believers once he had gone away. But here we read about what happened on that incredible day that still we are living from. And in Acts, the second chapter, beginning with verse 1, we read, "And when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And suddenly the sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. And they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. And verse 4 says this, and all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. This is such a unique day that we have this opportunity to remember what took place in John Wesley's life on May the 24th and to celebrate Pentecost. A few years ago, they made John Wesley bobblehead dolls. And those were presented. In fact, I bought that at conference and I gave Alan Packard a bobblehead doll. So John Wesley is here today and you watch him. We'll see how much he agrees with what we're talking about. But it was 277 years ago that this man's life was changed when he received the promised Holy Spirit into his life in a way that he had never experienced God before. But way beyond that, it was on the day of Pentecost that God did something that had never been done before in the way it was done. Because God is a God of imaginative insensitiveness to touch the lives of people. It's who God is. And you and I, we cannot ever outthink, outconnive, outdo how God uniquely touches our hearts and our lives and gets our attention. And on that day, God did something like he had never done before so that people could experience grace, experience his love, experience healing, experience God's presence, experience God's power so that they could really know the God of salvation. And that was that he gave out the fullness of himself through the Holy Spirit. And we're going to talk about what that means throughout this morning. And that's what happened on May the 24th, 1738, when John Wesley's attention was gotten by God in a way that he never expected, when his heart was so strangely warmed by the power and the presence of God, he experienced his own personal Pentecost on that day. Now, Pentecost is 50 days. It took place 50 days after the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It took place 10 days after Jesus had ascended to the Father's throne, which was 40 days after the resurrection. The believers, they were in Jerusalem. And it was on that day that God fulfilled the promise that he had made through his son Jesus. That he had made. See, if you read over here in Acts 1, Jesus tells them, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized you with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. That God would send his Holy Spirit. And so, God fulfilled that promise on that day of Pentecost when he sent the power from on high that would clothe the body of the believers and baptize them in the power from on high in heaven. Now, what really was going on and why they were in Jerusalem on this day that we call Pentecost that has a slight different meaning for us today is Pentecost means 50. And what it referred to when the believers had gathered in Jerusalem was it was a celebration of the grain harvest. It was a Jewish feast that was held 50 days after the second day of Passover to mark a time of thanksgiving for the grain harvest, for the end of the grain harvest. And the people were gathered there. And they traditionally two loaves of bread were prepared from the new wheat, and two yearling lambs were offered up as a thanksgiving and waved before the Lord. It was a time for praising God, for God's grace in giving the people the harvest. It was a time of gratitude in which people were expected to attend the feast, and in that expectation, they were required to also bring a gift, an offering that would be given. It was a freewill offering that would be given to the Lord. So the people were all together in this one place. And God, in his unique way, in God's imaginative incentiveness, chose this moment to fulfill the promise that he had made. It was on this day that the Lord began the great harvest of his church, of his people. It was on this day that God fulfilled the promise and sent the fullness of the Holy Spirit upon hearts that were so hungry, in lives that were so in need, lives that were changed. And it was on this moment that the body of Christ was ignited as it had never been before. And still today, you and I, we're so dependent upon the Holy Spirit. Continually, God is giving that gift. Now today, you know what? We cannot duplicate exactly what happened at the events on that day of Pentecost. You know, we all cannot take a pilgrimage to Jerusalem and enter into an upper room, and we all can't sit and wait for the infilling of the Holy Spirit to fall upon us. Nor can we all go to a house on Aldersgate Street and re-experience what took place in John Wesley's life. I mean, the house doesn't even exist anymore. But you know what? We may not be able to duplicate what took place exactly on the day of Pentecost and what took place exactly on Aldersgate Street on May the 24th, 1738. But what we can have is our own personal Pentecost encounters in which we experience the fullness of God's love being shown abroad in our heart through the power of His Holy Spirit. We can have that. I mean, what that requires of us is what had to happen for the believers at Pentecost and what had to happen for John Wesley. And that is that we have to have an open heart to God. And we have to have a willingness to be receptive to encountering God's Holy Spirit and allowing God's Holy Spirit to change us. Because God's Holy Spirit is a change agent that works so mightily. And we need Pentecost. You and I, we need Pentecost. We need the encounters with God's Holy Spirit. We need that. Just as a car needs gas to operate, and these light bulbs need electricity in order to burn, you and I, we need the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives to be the people that God has called us to be. We need it. God has created that. And God, in creating them, He provides it. And one of the incredible characteristics of the believers on that day of Pentecost is what we read about in the very first verses of chapter 2. It says that they were all together in one place. They were all together. If you read a King James Version or a New King James Version, it may say they were all together in one accord. And what we understand that to mean is that they were all together in one heart. And they were all together in one mind. And the early disciples, they're all 120 of them, they were united with desire to seek the face of God. They were united there. And unity is the force of the early believers. And in that unity, they witnessed by thought and by word and by deed, they witnessed the love of God, the salvation of Jesus Christ, and the indwelling empowerment of the Holy Spirit. Because they were together in that. There are so many aspects of the Holy Spirit and on who the person of God is that is manifest in the one we call the Holy Spirit. There is no way this sermon is going to tap on every aspect of it. What we're really focusing in on here is this verse 1, where it says they were all together. They were all together. They were a force that was to be reckoned with. And what you and I need today is a Pentecost like that. We need that personally in our lives, and we need that corporately as the church. We need the Pentecost where God's people walk in unity under the leadership of the Lord, enabled by the power of the Holy Spirit. We need a move of God in these days just like the early believers did. We need moves of God in our own lives just like John Wesley experienced. But no matter how often they were motivated by the Spirit, they continually worked under the influence of the Spirit. You know, sadly today, we are often more motivated by disunity than unity. It's amazing how we can get really stirred up over disunity rather than being stirred up over unity. And we do this politically, we do this morally, we do this spiritually. You know, social media this week, I have not been able to click on a Facebook page that I've not heard a personal or political thought of what has transpired in one of the members of the Duggars family. I mean, lines have been drawn rather than being unified over thought and deed. And we need another Pentecost where we invite the power of the Holy Spirit to clothe our lives with power on high, where we come together in unity and we become more like the infant church of the body of believers. I mean, they were united in purpose, they were united in prayer, they were united in power, and they were united in performance. In performance meaning ministry. Now, they were united people in purpose. And that is exactly what we talk about in verse 1, that they were willing to wait together on the Lord. God had told them to wait, and they did. And they strived together to be the ones that God was calling them to be. And they recognized and they gave value to the difference is that they had, that the Holy Spirit would provide for them so that they may become unified. See, if you go on and read here, we find out that they are from different nationalities, they have different abilities to speak, but suddenly their differences were all transformed under the influence of the Holy Spirit because they depended on the great uniter. They depended on it. And so must we. And they were united in prayer. They came together and they prayed with each other, and they prayed for one another. And they helped each other to know that they were willing to bear each other's burdens, even in their differences, that they were willing to come together in unity and be the community that God had called them to be under the influence of the Holy Spirit. Because there was a bond that, there is just a bond that develops when people are willing to pray together. And it happened. We need another Pentecost like that. And they were united in power. I mean, unity here came about for the infant church because they were open to God's power, not because they wanted to be in power. They were open to the power. And the power of God came through the openness that they had to the Holy Spirit. And they were willing to receive, just as John Wesley did. They were willing. And the unity produced amazing results in God's kingdom. Amazing results. And they were united in ministry. And how they would really live out of God's unifying power and influence in their life. Each one was busy doing their own part that God had so uniquely fitted them for through giftings that the Apostle Paul then we could go on to read about in the epistles. I mean, God did not send the Holy Spirit upon the life of the believer so they could simply set. He sent the fullness of the Holy Spirit on the life of the believer so they could serve. Serve. And in all of that, he united them. You and I, we need Pentecost. We need personal Pentecost. We need Pentecost in a way like we've never needed before. But we have to be open. And it requires changes to take place in us. But the changes are always amazing. Look at the change that took place in the life of John Wesley. He was broken. He was a place in which he was calling out for God. He was unsure of God's acceptance of him. But God met him exactly where he was and transformed his life and ignited a fire within his heart that influenced lives and believers to this very present moment. And God did it then, and God does it now. And so not only do we need a Pentecost, we have to be willing to be open to a Pentecost, and we have to be changed because of Pentecost. And see, that's the gift that God gives. For he said, Jesus tells them as he prepares to ascend to the Father's throne, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait. Wait for the gift my Father has promised. And now we know that we don't have to wait for the promised gift because the gift has come. We just have to be willing to be receptive to the gift. Are you open? Are you receptive? Because God is sending his power. And he's transforming us in his presence. And it is amazing what God can do when you and I are open. Lord, today we ask you, Father, reveal to us your Holy Spirit as possibly we've never experienced your Spirit before. Or rekindle the gift of your Spirit in our hearts. If we have experienced, but the flame has become simply just a little spark. Father, ignite within us your Spirit so that we are unified as the body of Christ. So that we just reveal to a watching world the power of your kingdom. Change our hearts, God. For we ask you to do it once again. Do it once again. And we ask this believing fully in your Son, our resurrected Lord and Savior, who proclaimed the promise of your Holy Spirit. Father, do it once again. It's in your holy name we pray, and together we say, amen. This morning our closing hymn is number 347. It's called Spirit Song, and as we share together in this song, it's also a song of invitation, and that is, if you want to be in a time of personal prayer, know that the altar is here for you. If you want to be in a time of being prayed with by one of us as pastors, we are invited to come forward. If you feel led to become a part of this church family on transfer of your membership from another church family, we invite you to do so. Or if you feel led to profess your faith in Jesus Christ, confess him as your Lord and Savior because you've never done that before and become a part of the church family, we invite you to do so. We invite you to stand and join with us as together we sing this song of reception, Spirit Song. It's hymn number 347.
Yeah.
Father, we prepare to go out into a waiting and watching world. And send us forth as believers that are open to your Spirit's leadership, that empowered by your Spirit's love, and lead by example through you. Father, send us forth in the knowledge that you're a God who's faithful in our past, you're faithful in this present, and you are the one who is faithful for your future. For we ask this in the saving name of your Son, our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. And together we say, amen. Remember, you and I are not called to come to church, but who are we called to be? Be the church. Have a great day. Thank you for being here.